while we will share some thoughts with you. So this is the lunch session of the Women in Public Policy Program. And I'm Iris Bohnet. I am here in my role as director of this program, but of course you've seen me before in my role as academic dean. I see many old friends in the room, some new friends in the room. So for those of you who are older friends, you might already know a lot of what I'm going to talk to you about. But hopefully there will be lots of new insights as well. Here at the Women in Public Policy Program, our goal is to close gender gaps, to do research, to teach around closing gender gaps in economic opportunity, health, education, and political participation. Let me tell you, maybe in three kind of points, why, if you don't already care, you should care. Care about gender equality. Why it is hard to do something about it. And then thirdly, take you a little bit on the journey of our research center on what we're trying to do. So why should you care? There's lots of reasons why you should care, but one of my favorite studies was run by Rob Jensen in India. And he exploited the fact that the call centers went into India in the 90s in large numbers and preferably hired women. He was interested in whether these increased economic opportunities for women would translate into how parents treat their children. So his thesis was, maybe even the poorest of the poor think in terms of returns on investment. So increasing economic opportunities for these women, of course, many more likely that these women work in call centers. And if we can't fix this, then maybe I am going just to turn this off. Let me try this and see whether this works better. Good. So call centers, economic opportunities for women, and the question was, one question was, would these women go and work there? But more importantly, does this translate into how parents treat their daughters? And he was interested, in fact, in combating gendercide. As you probably know, the UN now estimates that about 150 million girls are missing in India and China and South Asia because of sex-selective abortion or gendercide in the first 5 years, which is neglect in the first 5 years. So the end of the story is, after 10 years of evaluating what the impact of these call centers was on these girls' survival chances and on their likelihood of going to school, that yes, even for these kinds of very difficult issues, you can impact change by providing economic opportunities for women. And these girls were much more likely to survive, go to school, have good grades, without hurting the boys. So this is a real success story, a win-win situation where the parents didn't start neglecting their boys, their sons, but started to treat their daughters in a different way than they had ever done before. So that's why we should care. We should really care, because closing gender gaps, now in particular thinking about economic opportunity, but more generally, saves lives. But you should also care, not only because it's the right thing to do, but of course it is the right thing to do, but it's also the smart thing to do. So now we have increasing evidence from all kinds of walks of life, from corporate boards, from gender diversity in teams, but also from India. In fact, given that India had such a big election just now, let me share with you one other example from India. And that is the question of, do female politicians behave differently than their male counterparts? This is a study that Rohini Pandey and Esther Duflo have been involved in. They've been following Indian towns for the last 20 years, because in 1993, India amended its constitution with the provision that a third of the village heads had to be female. And what they found was that these women do provide more public goods than their male counterparts. So there's also an efficiency case, not just an equality case or an equity case to be made. But I think at this point, we feel quite strongly that yes, there is a business case in addition to the human rights case. So that's why you should care. And still, we're moving slowly. We're making progress, but we're moving slowly. Why is it hard to achieve gender equality? So again, I want to give you just one data point with lots of studies that many of us here in this room have been involved in. But one study that was particularly important, I think, in informing my thinking. And that was a study by Claudia Golden and Cecilia Rice, examining the impact of orchestras having their musicians audition behind a curtain. As you probably know, many large orchestras now do auditions behind curtains. And why do they do that? Because they thought that maybe that's going to increase the chances of underrepresented groups to be selected into the orchestra. And indeed, it has a huge impact. Increases the likelihood that women will be chosen by 30 percentage points. So curtains are important, but unfortunately not very practical for most of your jobs and for most of my job when we have to select people. And so a lot of my research has been focusing on what are alternatives to curtains. And what can all of we who are in this room because we believe that it is both the right thing and the smart thing to do to close these gender gaps, what can we do? What are our alternatives? And that's really leading me to my third and last point. How can we fix what is broken? And Women on the Public Policy Program basically has focused on two areas, broad areas. One is we have to acknowledge that systems are the way they are, that we don't always have the luxury of curtains, so therefore we have to enable women to navigate the system more successfully. And Hannah Riley Bowles, my colleague here, has done some of the most groundbreaking research that there is on gender in negotiation. How can we help women succeed in the world that we live in, knowing that particularly negotiation or competition often is a risky thing for women to do? So she'll talk to you about that in just a moment. But in addition, of course, we don't want to stop there, but we also want to fix the system or redesign the system. So I've been thinking about different policy types of interventions, the effectiveness of quotas, and much of my work has been inspired by the fact that I'm a behavioral economist, and I've looked at how insights into how our minds work can inform how we evaluate people, for example. You might be familiar with the book Nudge by Cass Sunstein and Richard Thaler, and that's what we're developing at the Women in Public Policy Program, or have been developing over the past 5 years, are gender equality nudges. How can we nudge the environment to increase the chances that you choose the best musician and you do the right thing and don't discriminate against someone? And so this really is another example of a win-win solution where you can do the right thing and the smart thing for your organization. Just one example. When you hire or promote or evaluate someone next time, think about whether you do this one at a time. So this young attorney is coming up for promotion to partner, and so you're just evaluating her. But that's the one-off thing. Or are you looking at multiple candidates at the same time? It turns out, for those of you who've just been at Larry Summers' talk, this will sound familiar, that diversification is a good thing. And if you hire or promote or look at various candidates at the same time, diversity is much more likely to emerge because you think of the people you look at as a portfolio. And as we know, in all good portfolio decisions, we diversify the kinds of choices that we make. And you will be much less likely to hire 10 of the same if you hire them at the same time than when you hire sequentially. Because every time when you hire sequentially, you'll have this inner reference person here in your head, and you will compare the young attorney who is coming up for promotion to partner with your reference point in your head. And that reference point may be male, it may be white, it may be American, it may be lots of the things that don't necessarily include diversity in your organization. So that's one thing you can do, and one thing that I'm happy to say as academic dean, I am trying to do as we are evaluating faculty here for the Kennedy School, that we make decisions in bundles and try to hire three at the same time rather than looking at psychologists in September and economists in February and sociologists in March. And every time we're thinking like we're doing the right thing, but can't help but compare this new person with our reference in our minds. So all of this and much more is happening at the Women in Public Policy Program, but right now we're at a very interesting point in our lives, in the life of the center, where we have a lot of good research and a lot of demand out there in the world to get these insights to the world. And you'll hear shortly from an amazing panel that's going to be moderated by Victoria Budson, the executive director of our program, on how our research has impact right here in Boston and newly will have impact in Massachusetts. We're also trying something new that I think is pretty unprecedented, and Carrie, maybe you could show it quickly. We've created a new online platform that we call the Gender Action Portal GAP, where we make research on how to close gender gaps available to the world, and not just as research papers, but we provide summaries, we make it easy for practitioners, for decision makers, policy makers around the world to learn about what has been proven to work if you want to close gender gaps, for example, on compensation. So this is kind of the front page. So Kara is clicking on compensation. You can also do search terms, of course. You could put in the wage gap, but we're doing compensation right now. So this will take you...
Go to Wi-Fi Harvard University.
This will take you to a different... Yes, that's right. So we'll take you to this page here, which shows you kind of a map of different where the interventions have been tested in different parts of the world. These are all experiments. So that was kind of one variable that constrains what we can include in this in our online platform, in that we really only want to include studies where you can prove causality, where we can really say X led to the outcome Y. But these are old field experiments or lab experiments, randomized controlled trials. So different parts of the world. And then, for example, here you could click on, I think that's Hannah's paper right there. Click on Hannah's paper. Then you find a summary of Hannah's paper, How Can Women Escape the Compensation Negotiation Dilemma? Gives you a quick summary. You can search by author. You can search by country that you're interested in. You can search by sector that you're interested in. And hopefully, this platform is going to be useful for all of you and the broader world. But really, our next step has to be to help cities like Boston, companies committed to closing gender gaps and bringing all these insights to action in the world of practice. And that's where we'll be heading in our discussion this afternoon. But with that, let me turn to Hannah, who is going to tell us a little bit more about the second aspect. So one really important one, of course, is fixing the system. But equally important is that we have to enable all of us to succeed in that system. Hannah.
Thank you. So, am I all right working from? Okay. All right, super, thank you. So I'm gonna try in just a few minutes to talk about something that I'd love to talk with you about for hours, so I'm gonna go fast. But I wanna share with you some findings from studies that have been supported by WAP. And as Iris mentioned, I'm going to take this perspective of the individual navigating. I think this research also has implications for organizations, and our panelists will talk more about that. But I'm going to take the perspective of the individual navigating. And I want to talk about three things to remember about gender and job negotiations. So the first one is opportunity, okay? And I'm going to argue that women sometimes have less opportunity than men to negotiate. The second idea is ambiguity, and I'm going to explain what I mean by ambiguity, and why ambiguity heightens the potential for gender differences in negotiation outcomes. Okay? And my third idea relates to work and family. And what I'm basically going to propose to you all is that if we really want to understand the role of negotiation in phenomena such as the gender wage gap or the gender gap in leadership positions, we really need to understand how negotiations, or we need to not only focus on negotiations between employees and their employers, but also consider how those negotiations between employees and employers are fundamentally interlinked with the negotiations that employees engage with domestic partners, so family members, other household partners, okay? So first, why do I argue that women sometimes have less opportunity than men to negotiate for career advancement? One reason is social networks, and the other one is gender stereotypes. Very briefly on social networks, research by sociologists show that particularly in male-dominated environments, if when you ask men and women about their networks, both their work networks, who helps you get things done, and then your social networks, you know, for who are your friends, who provides you social support, that men will report overwhelmingly male networks and a lot of overlapping ties between their friends with the people that they're also helping them get things done, right? For women, they'll tend to report more gender diverse networks of people who help them get things done within their organization. And often in male dominated environments, they'll report that their friends, their social support network is outside of the organization, right? So what sociologists argue, and there's good data to support, is that, you know, when you're in a social system where you are better, more closely socially connected to those people who have control over resources and opportunities for career advancement, you're more likely to be able to access those opportunities. So social networks matter. Now, why would I argue that gender stereotypes matter? There are things called descriptive gender stereotypes. These are our ideas about how we think men and women behave and what they prefer. Men are better at sports than women. They like sports better. You know, women are better at caregiving. They like kids better or something like that. Those are descriptive stereotypes. There are also stereotypes that are called prescriptive stereotypes. And these are ideas about what we think is ideal or appropriate behavior by men and women. What is attractive behavior by men and women? And one part of the prescriptive feminine stereotype, the feminine ideal, is that women put others ahead of themselves. Right? They're not self-oriented. And so the challenge in a negotiation situation, when you want to negotiate for more pay or something more for yourself, particularly maybe competitively for something for advancement, that you violate this sort of ideal feminine image. And so what we found in studies is that we expose people to a woman, say a videotape of a woman in a placement interview for a job. She's moving up in her company. And we have her talk for a while about some of her management experience, and then there's an opportunity to negotiate. You know, did you receive your package? And she lets it pass. All right, we show the same video to a randomly selected other set of people. She describes her management experience. The opportunity to negotiate comes, and she takes it. She asks for higher compensation and a bonus. And what we find is that the woman who negotiated, people say they don't want to work with her as much as the woman who let the opportunity to pass, right, and stayed mum. Now, I'm not arguing this can't happen to men. I think men can overdo it too. But what we found in a lot of studies we found and then has been replicated in other labs is that there is a significant and a greater social cost, social risk for women doing this than there is for men. The important takeaway from this is that there's a lot of press about, oh, women don't negotiate, women don't ask for things, we need to train them, we need to build their confidence. There's even been legislation in Congress to train women to negotiate to close the gender wage gap. And what's important from that research is that we recognize that this is actually a quite reasonable response by women to be more reticent than men to negotiate, right? If it is actually a more socially tricky situation, right? So it is not a deficiency on the part of women, it is actually an appropriate interpretation of the social context. Just very quickly, I couldn't resist showing you this. What's very important is that we distinguish negotiating for yourself from negotiating for somebody else. And we've run a number of studies on this, as have other folks replicating it. This is a result of one study that was done with an executive group, and we looked at whether you were negotiating for pay for yourself or for somebody else. It really didn't make a big difference for men, but for women, the effect was substantial. You usually get a lot of nods from women in this situation. So, what's key here is that we don't generalize and assume like women aren't good negotiators just because they get an icky feeling advocating for themselves. They get an icky feeling because they're realizing this is a tough situation, right? They're great negotiators on behalf of others, but the question is, what can we do about this? How can we get women, how can we harness women's excellence in negotiation and figure out what are the strategies that women can use so that they get what they want advocating for themselves and also make the social impression that they want. And I'm going to talk very briefly about that. So this research that Iris just cited is on what we call relational accounts. We tried a whole bunch of different strategies in the lab looking at what effects different types of negotiating strategies had, both on people's willingness to grant what the negotiator was asking for and on the social impression that they made. How willing would you be to work with this person? Would you benefit from it? Would you hire this person? We call it relational accounts. Sheryl Sandberg picked this up later. She calls it I-we, which is so much better than relational accounts. That's why I'm in academia and she's like selling things by the billions. What she says is it's about think I and talk we. And the basic essence of it is that you want to take the other side's perspective. You want to explain why your negotiating is legitimate in their eyes, not in your eyes, not just because I deserve it, but why in their eyes is your negotiating legitimate. And you want to signal that you're taking their perspective. So Sheryl's got this great example from her own book about negotiating her package at Facebook. And she says what she said was, of course you realize that you're hiring me to run your deal team, so you want me to be a good negotiator. Such a great line, right? You should be worrying if I'm not negotiating, right? That you're not making the right hire. But then she goes on to say, and this is the only time you and I will ever be on opposite sides of the table, right? And so what we've done, we've got a number of examples of these types of things that we'll work through, for instance, in training programs and stuff like this. Now, this I-we strategy is great advice for any negotiator. It's not just great advice for women, but the nice thing about it for women is that it helps women, you know, navigate this pinch point. And I think also when you realize that you're walking in and what you're offering is something that will make sense to that other person and it's effectively a win-win, you feel better and more relaxed and confident walking into the negotiation. Okay, so my takeaway from my first challenge opportunity, is that we argue you want to enhance your negotiation through relationships, right? So you have to think about building and leveraging your network. But you also want to think about enhancing your relationships through negotiations. You know, signaling to the other party that you're taking on their perspective. Oh, am I going the wrong direction? Oh, no. I thought I had multiple. Enhance your relationships. So you want to take the counterpart's perspective, explaining why it's legitimate, as I said, and then signaling that you're taking on that. What is the win-win in this for both of you? Okay. Challenge two, ambiguity. So why do I argue that ambiguity heightens the potential for gender outcomes? It's not the ambiguity itself, actually. What it is that when we walk into a situation and we don't really know how to enact it, we look to cues in the social environment and our own mental schema, our own associations for how to enact the situation. And if the context is gendered or our own past experience is gendered, then gender has more potential to influence our behavior. So there's two types of ambiguity we can think about, norm ambiguity and structural ambiguity. Norm ambiguity is the how should I negotiate in this type of a situation? And what's interesting is that research indicates that when you actually give, for instance, male and female MBAs a sense of how a company is expecting them to negotiate, this gender difference in the propensity to negotiate goes away altogether, right? Women know what is expected within the context. They're not as worried about, oh, as a woman, how should I behave, right? Now, structural ambiguity is the what should you negotiate, right? And so what's very important there is what we find is that, I'll give you hundreds of studies on this, but basically the idea there is when it's unclear what is up for negotiation, you can get men and women entering the negotiation with different aspirations or also their negotiating counterpart having different expectations for them as opposed to other. A lot of this boils down to our propensity, or often boils down to our propensity to compare ourselves and compare others to similar others, okay? And there can be, so when I think about like how much I'm paid, I might think about, well, how am I doing relative to a girlfriend, right? Or in our information search, if I'm trying to figure out how much I should ask, I might ask some of the closest people to me, and those might be women, right? If a guy's heading into a compensation negotiation, he might ask the people closest to him what he should negotiate for, right? However, if men on average are being paid more than women, right, the guy who asked his friends and the woman who asked her friends might enter the negotiation with different numbers, right? So we have to think about the takeaway from this, the ambiguity piece, is how do we enhance transparency for ourselves, also within our organizations, with regard to how to negotiate and what's negotiable, but also to think about how not to let gender bias your information search itself, right? How do you walk in with really the best information that will lead you to the most advantageous outcome from the negotiation? Okay, now I'll go to my third challenge. The third challenge is work and family. So far, what I've been talking about is really just primarily negotiations between employees and employers. But this is a part, but if, for instance, you look at the gender wage gap, right? The gender wage gap is primarily explained by the occupation that you are in, the number of years you have been in the workforce, and the number of hours per week that you work. Particularly for college-educated workers, professional workers, there remains an unexplained gap that is likely related to bias or some of these dynamics, perhaps in the negotiation process that I've been describing. But most of it has to do with the fact that women overwhelmingly take over household management, care of children, but also care of, you know, aging parents, ailing siblings, and things like that. And so that creates, it is that asymmetric division of the unpaid labor that influences women's participation in the paid labor workforce. So I just want to, and I'm going to end my little talk here with a couple takeaways related to work and family. And and one of them is, I think the key thing that we need to do is to work on, look at the work-family win-wins. There's a general propensity for negotiators to look at, to walk into a negotiation thinking that it's a fixed pie, thinking that, you know, more for you is going to be less for me. I think particularly in the dialogue about work and family, the way it's discussed in the press, if you're not, you know, if you have family, then you're not going to be as good of a worker, or if you're at work, then you're not going to be as big of a good family contributor. And I think most of us realize that in our lived experience, there's actually a lot of mutual gains between the two spheres. And there are a lot of examples, even like a flexible work schedule, for instance, is a great example of a win-win. You could decide, because somebody has to leave the office at a certain hour, then, oh, this isn't going to work. They can't be a responsible worker. But if you gave them a flexible work schedule in order to meet whatever their time constraints were, and they were able to work either in the evenings or something, or early in the morning, or on a longer day schedule, missing one afternoon, that they could still contribute as a full-time worker and also meet some of their other responsibilities. And I think, actually, Kathleen, you're going to talk about how you make this work in your organization. And the final thing I'll hit on is it's really important to think about, for organizations and for women, to think about how do you negotiate for long-term as well as short-term success. You know, how can we help women negotiate careers so that they can stay employed and engaged in maintaining and building their social capital through pinch points that might otherwise leave them out of the workforce. So I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Hannah. So you've now heard about the research, what it is that we're discovering, what we know. And you've all heard because you came today. And our director, Iris Bohnet, talked about how we now have the Gender Action Portal. So one of the ways we bring our work to scale is by providing, in an open source, unrestricted way, information that any person on the planet can access and use, as long as they can read in English and have access to the internet. But that's not the only way that we can make change and difference. And I'm going to invite two terrific colleagues to join me for a panel discussion with all of us today. Secretary of Labor, Rachel Kaprielian, who is actually an alum of the Harvard Kennedy School. I believe you're 2003. We had an overlap year. And Kathy Horgan, who's the Executive Vice President and Chief Operating Officer for Human Resources at State Street Bank. Now, how is it that the three of us come together? So another way that we cause change in the world and our research moves forward is through our students. Who in the room is a current or former student of the Kennedy School? Okay. So what has been an incredibly dynamic, unexpected gain of the 18 years of the Women in Public Policy program is by having this type of inquiry and research. What we've been able to do is develop an entire field. So now there is a known field of expertise that has been professionalized that one can think of as gender consulting, diversity consulting, talent management, and engagement in terms of interventions cross-field and sectorally. One of our breathtaking students, and here's the secret, which those of you who raised your hands already know, all of our students are breathtaking. Average is not represented within the Kennedy School, truly. Both in terms of expertise and talent and raw intellectual capacity, But I think perhaps equally, if not more important, is in spirit and will. Nobody comes to the Kennedy School because they kind of thought of it one day. People come to the Kennedy School because they fundamentally want to make the world different from how it is. And they believe they were good enough to apply to a place like Harvard. They were talented enough to get in. And they have a passion that they want to pursue. And it's that passion that really creates this vortex of change. And we had a student named Kathryn Lusk. And after being part of our From Harvard Square to the Oval Office program and taking classes here, she had a strong passion and followed it. And I'll tell you the narrative as I experienced it. I was at an appointment. I'm the original, one of the original founders of the center. And I pick up the paper and I'm reading the State of the City speech of Mayor Menino. I have lived in the Boston area nearly all my life. He's been mayor here for more than 20 years. And as I read through it, all of a sudden, I'm reading about data-driven, metrics-based interest in making Boston the best city in the United States for working women. And in what was then his 19th year or so, I thought, this is unusual. And I had worked with his team before, and that they'd be at events that I would often be at for those who focused on women, nothing like this. And I thought, that's really interesting. And then I went and had my eyes checked. So I was in a waiting room, which is where most of us read things that we don't all the time. And a few days later, I received an email from our former student, Kathryn Lusk, letting me know that she was a bump fellow of the mayor and was working on his gender portfolio. And then I understood why. I had just read that the mayor had a 4-point plan, one of which was to create something called the Women's Workforce Council to close the wage gap in Boston. He wanted Boston to be the first city in the United States to close the wage gap. Fast forward, a committee was created. Kathryn was the staff person who did the metrics and the framing of what would happen. They had people from throughout the city, small and medium-sized enterprise. Businesses were represented. Major multinationals, such as State Street, were represented. Those within academia who have knowledge and information on how to close gender gaps, like the interventions we heard about. And we built a plan together, public, private, academic partnership. And it rolled out quickly. The mayor ended up, unfortunately, not being well, and that pushed her timeline. Kathryn Lusk was having a child, and that pushed our timeline because she's like, let's get it all done before I go out on leave. And in about 10 months' time, we created a white paper which listed all of the different interventions that one could kind of easily uptake, 33, and we developed something called 100% Talent, the Boston Women's Compact. And by doing so, we invited businesses from across the city to sign the compact, and it's what we call a gender nudge. And this nudge, as Iris Bohnet talked about, not a regulation, not a requirement, but to give people a pathway to success that they can opt into. And I now want to turn it over to my colleagues to talk about, once the businesses signed this pledge, what did that look like and what happened from it? And the pledge was that you had to act. You had to choose 3 interventions to make happen with inside your organization. You needed to think and reflect. You had to have some internal analysis process of what has happened. And then you needed to share that data back to an institution that could then analyze it, so as a community, as a regional community, we could think and learn together. And I wanted to begin by asking Kathy Horgan to talk about, why was State Street, an incredibly successful major employer within Massachusetts, interested in this work, enough both to sign, but also to really participate and bring resources to bear within the Women's Workforce Council?
Great, thanks Victoria. I think for a variety of reasons. So first of all, I've spent my entire career in human resources, so I spend a lot of my waking hours thinking about developing talent and engaging talent. And at State Street, that's a very big priority for us as we think about our workforce. And I'd say roughly about half our total workforce are women.
And so when you think about engaging women and bringing the most engaged people to work, that means, you know, translates to business success for us. When you have things like people feeling they're not paid fairly, that doesn't translate into very engaged employees. And that creates business issues for us. That might be me.
Give her another one, just give her another handout.
I won't have any problems.
We can make this easy.
Thanks.
Okay. So as we were, you know, looking at issues around engagement. Thank you.
Thank you. Shut this off completely. So I have problems. I apologize about that. We'll take that off.
All right. Good. All right. Back to business. And as we were thinking about these issues around engagement and talent, it became really clear that we need to do everything we can to make sure we have an engaged workforce. That translates into people who are innovative, who are bringing the best ideas, who are really bringing everything they can bear to State Street and to our clients and ultimately to our bottom line. And if you look at just sort of research, there's so much research out there, but and this is a little bit more of a US data point. We think about it certainly on a global basis. Some research done by Gallup recently said only 30% of US workers are engaged in their roles. A full 18% are actively disengaged. They're coming to work every day, but they're actively disengaged. So they basically just, you know, quit, but they're still coming to work. That they estimate costs $500 million a year. So when you think about what are the issues around engaging employees, and when you think again about half our workforce are women, issues like feeling you're not paid fairly become very big issues. And so for us, it became very easy to say this is an issue we need to tackle. And I think the other point I was going to make is we've done a lot of research around why, you know, where wage disparity exists. And we know that for us, a lot of the issue, one of the major drivers is we don't have women well represented in the highest paying roles. And so, again, we needed to start to think about what does that translate into? How do we think about closing the opportunity gap that exists to get at the wage issue? And so really it became very much a no-brainer in a lot of ways. We knew we have these issues. We want to be able to solve them. We know we can't solve them entirely on our own. We need to work in communities that have really vibrant policies and programs that allow for a talent pool that we can draw from. And it really became a very, just another public way for us as an organization to say to the women in our organization and potential employees of State Street, this is a real priority for us and we care about it.
And one of the things I'll mention in terms of what type of partnership that State Street brought to the table. So just as State Street knew that they needed additional external expertise to help solve the problem, we also needed external expertise. We could not have functionally worked either from the academic side or from the government policy side. We couldn't have done it without their partnership. First, anyone who's worked in a big corporation understands that things can end up on the HR team where they're trying to solve this investment leverage issue. You've got your talent pool, you've already invested and trained, so it's a sunk cost. But in addition to knowing what to do, it's got to make it through the Office of the General Counsel. And if the lawyers don't agree, it's not going to happen. And when you talk about the wage gap, and when we say wage gap, you know, what do people think in the room? What do you think the wage gap is in the US? Does anyone know? For every 75 cents, 77. Nationally, it's 77. And when we say the wage gap, we're comparing overall female wages to what a white male makes. That is what the usual statistic relays. But when we say women, women is a really blunt term. It doesn't really in any way excavate what one's set of lives within a city look like. Here in Boston, white women are making 83 cents on the dollar. African American women are making 56 cents to the white male dollar. Hispanic women, 54 cents. Now, when you compare what African American women are making compared to African American men, they make 1 cent more than their male colleagues. And the same is true for Hispanic women. But when you're talking about 83 cents, and if you take away all of the variables that Hannah talked about, choosing or not choosing, but needing to spend time outside the office, that still leaves a 7% gap. And I think there are very few individuals, families, or communities that would want 7% of their earnings taken away for no good reason. So we needed to get this through the Office of the General Counsel, not just, of course, for State Street, but every different corporation. And because you're talking about wages, and we have something called the EEOC in the United States. On the state level, it's called MCAD, which is the entity that governs whether or not workers are paid fairly. When a corporation says that they're working on this, they have to say it in a way that they're not admitting guilt. I mean, if you think about it, it's a tricky problem, because you're saying we need to solve something that if we say we need to solve, we're doing something which is outside the lines. So we wanted to get it right, because it's a nudge, it's not a regulation. So State Street worked with their attorneys to make sure we could figure out how to functionally implement it, how it could actually be something corporations could uptake and use as a resource in their toolkit for talent management, rather than to put it all the way over in compliance. Compliance means, and you know, I'm sure I'll get nods from my colleagues in different corporations, once it's in the compliance bucket, it's really tough to be flexible and nimble and innovative. Then it's about holding the line. And State Street spent hours and days and weeks working on it till we got it right. And then when we brought it public, it happened to be, wait for it, the morning after Boston won the World Series. So there's good planning, there's good research, but there's also luck. Yes, absolutely. And it meant that when our press conference took place, City Hall was filled with reporters because they were going to cover the mayor talking about the win of the Sox. And we had positive and negative high press stories on every significant day that we did a press conference. I think that we had good luck in the stars and in the atmosphere that perhaps something, someone, or some energy was looking down on us well. But we ended up having 50 corporations sign immediately, whether that was people from Main Street or major multinationals. And as all this was swirling around, it wasn't just women workers and corporations that were listening, but other parts of state government. And that leads us to Secretary Rachel Kaprielian, who's had a really long, distinguished career prior to coming here to the Kennedy School. She, I believe, was the youngest woman ever elected to the Watertown City Council. She then went on to be a state representative. While a state representative, she was a Rappaport Fellow, and I give a nod to Phyllis Rappaport. She and her husband made that possible and that system of educating leaders within state and local government possible. She came to the Kennedy School. Somewhere along the way, she had a law degree that she picked up along the way, had been a Bunting Fellow at Harvard, and then came to the Kennedy School, ran the Department of Motor Vehicles, and then was tapped to be in the cabinet and became a cabinet secretary, and I'll let you pick up from there.
Thank you. Well, this has been very, you know, provocative, this discussion. And I have had a lot of years in public service, and I was a lot of firsts. I was the first woman in my rep district to ever be elected. I was the first woman chair of the first committee that I chaired. But as Governor Patrick says so well, it doesn't matter if you're first if there's not a second. So it's important that we think about not just, you know, the success of any one, you know, female in a new position, or even if she's doing amazingly, you know, innovative and iconoclastic things. We have to make sure that there's a pipeline. And this effort that the governor spearheaded, and by the way, I have to put in a plug for my boss, not just because he's my boss, Governor Deval Patrick, but in his administration right now, in upper level positions, upper level management, members of his senior staff, members of the cabinet, he stands at 49% women. This is a man who has walked the walk. And he understands that this has been good for him, good for government, good for business. And that is why we will continue to push for more women in C-suites, more women in the pipeline, more women in decision-making positions, because it is good for business. And that is why business will follow, when there will be all that data that we've collected over so many years and a system in place where these talented, creative, hardworking, amazing women stay and grow and get promoted. So part of what we're trying to do on this task force is, what are those factors that have women who step off or step back? Now, sometimes that is a series of things in their own lives, as we all have, men, women, whomever, to step off or not take that promotion or take that job change or move to that city. But how often are there smaller things, like you turn the dial a little to the left or a little to the right, flexible work schedules, as was mentioned, a culture that supports it. There was data by my friend Victoria Budson that she communicated.
And tell them what the task force is.
Yes, the task force is made up of women in government, in the private sector, in nonprofit, to get together to determine what we can do, what tangible steps can we take during this administration to retain some of that female talent, to put more women on boards, to not just walk the walk in state government, but encourage the private sector and the nonprofit world to do the same thing. And the way we are doing this in state government for women in management positions is another part of this task force is to institute a fellowship program modeled on the Rappaport Fellowship Program, I might add, where women will be put in positions of senior strategic development space in management in and around state government for 1 year. It will pay well. It will be graduate students or the most likely applicant pool. And I just looked at the descriptions from my fellow secretariats. They are awesome. Awesome. These are real positions that will make a real difference, that either will be one that you can turn over relatively easily in a year, or a project that is going to finish and land by the end of the fellowship. So they have been very carefully tailored, and they were really listening to me when I said that in the cabinet meeting, that we really need to make sure that these are meaty, these are consequential, and that these will give those women a great resume builder and hopefully to stay in that arena. My personal favorite is the one I drew up, which is an economist. So there we have an economist in our Executive Office of Labor and Workforce Development who was like a one-arm paper hanger. She does it all. She's been around since the 1970s, and there's a million things that she wants to dig into in a much more relevant way that will matter in our agency and in state government, and our fellowship is going to work with her. And she is the happiest person, I think, in state government, because she's going to be the one looking through a lot of the resumes. So it is online. If you want to look on our website, you can go to mass.gov. It's on the front page of mass.gov. And we're working with the Center for Women in Business at Bentley, and they're helping us to craft this because we want to mimic it in the private sector. So please, if you know some fabulous women who want to be a part of it, please encourage them to apply.
And the narrative that I want to make sure we make transparent is, it went from an idea, an understanding of how it is that we can close gender gaps, traveling through our student, Kathryn Lusk, into the mayor's office. It then got embedded structurally into the work of the mayor's office. And I want to recognize Megan Costello. She is the new director of the Office of Women's Advancement for the mayor. And she does not serve for Mayor Menino, but of course, Mayor Walsh. So as the administration shifted, the new administration took up this work. We, of course, made sure there were pledges made before the election took place, the committee not being foolish in any way. Yeah, it was a good strategy. And let me also note that Megan was the campaign manager. So she is the person that made sure that Marty Walsh got elected, and when she was asked what portfolio she wanted, that's the portfolio she wanted. And I'm actually gonna call on you in a few minutes to tell a little bit about what's going on now and how the narrative's continued. And then, once it was viewed what could happen on the city level, if a year ago you had walked up to someone in Boston and said, do you think closing the wage gap for women is a priority? I think it would have been rare. You would have heard yes. And if you had asked, will it be Mayor Menino's priority? I don't think the answer would have been yes. He's a good person, but this was just not a front burner issue. And then if you ask, would you get the major employers, the largest employers with hundreds of thousands of workers, how many Massachusetts workers at State Street?
We have about 18,000 in the state of Massachusetts.
Will the interventions that are being uptaken by State Street just impact Massachusetts workers, or will it go company-wide?
No, we're taking this, anything that we're, any of the interventions that we're selecting, the work that we're doing when we look at wage equity, we're looking at that across our global workforce. And we're in 20, we have about 30,000 employees worldwide. We're in, we've got big locations in at least 26 countries, but we operate in over 100 countries, so we've got people all around the world. So this will benefit women everywhere.
And then multiply that by 60 major companies, and you begin to see the depth of impact, the number of structural shifts, because it's great to give women tools, but it would be ideal to make systems where women don't need a separate toolkit to navigate. And then it got picked up on the state level. Secretary Kaprielian chairs the Successful Family, Successful Women, Successful Families Task Force, and again, there's a coalition of us. There's three different secretaries who serve on the committee, as well as those from academia and business. And I would now like to open it up. We have microphones at each place, kind of. We are one short, but we will figure that out. Here, we're going to share up here. Does that work? And people are welcome to come and ask questions of anyone who has spoken. In addition, I'm going to offer you up, Megan, if you don't mind. Okay. Thank you. We have a question in the back.
Thank you very much. We're physicians, and I went to the Kennedy School last year, and I was able to work out with one of my male colleagues a job share so that I could attend. But one of the areas where there's nowhere near equitable kind of arrangements is in medicine. And we're not looking necessarily at the monetary equivalency in terms of economic gaps. We're looking at advancement of careers to the point of chairmanships, to the point of partnerships, even with kind of creative job arrangements. Mm-hmm. And I think that medicine is one of those areas that has been left behind when it comes to efforts. Just efforts, that's not even discussed. I would love for some kind of initiative in medicine to go forward looking at the disparities that exist in career advancement as much as, because career advancement speaks to power and authority in terms of being able to ensure the next generation of female physicians who are coming to the field and equitable arrangements with chairmanships, with, you know, professorship development and things of that nature. So medicine is really a difficult area, and one of the things that is a misconception is this whole notion of millennium kids coming forward having different desires because women want to stay home with their children. But in my private partnership that I've been in for 20 years, men want paternity leave as much as the women, and it's always an issue. And so I think that's one thing that we struggle with. And then you didn't mention this, but I was in a meeting with other women, and they talked about this notion of being the first, and another woman comes along, and there's this syndrome called tripping the prom queen.
Yeah. We often call it queen bee, but I think tripping the prom queen is just a really fabulous phrase for that.
I wanted you to comment on that notion, because I know that, Iris, you probably have had some of those issues that come forward.
So first, that is a really salient and important point. Medicine has been one of these bastions where even though women have gained access to entry into the field, ability to advance, or in essence to have freedom of movement within the different specialties, women have not been able to crack that nut, and more importantly, the institutions have not effectively changed to fully utilize women's contribution and talent. Within the women's workforce, Council, Paula Johnson, I'm not sure which region you're from, if you're familiar. Paula Johnson is on the faculty here at Harvard, and she is the director of the Mary Horgan Connors Women's Health Center. One of the things that we looked at was women in medicine, an advancement both for physicians, and then as physicians move up through the administrative ranks, but also looking at care workers throughout the hospital systems, because that type of hierarchy and bias is really reflected throughout. And I think when I last looked, there were only 13 women who headed surgical departments within the whole United States. And it's, and for example, surgery is kind of a very significantly male field, and there's a machismo where during the surgery, no one takes a break. Surgeries are 12 hours. If you're a nursing mother, think about how that plays out. And there's all types of issues and bias, but that's a nut we're trying to crack. And I would love to draw upon your expertise and connect you with people who are working on that if that's of interest. Excellent point. Other comments and questions? Yes?
Is there any hope of bringing up that 83 cents so that we're finally equal, at least in Massachusetts, with the mail?
Well, I'm going to turn it to the Secretary of Labor because I'm certainly going to give her an opportunity to answer that.
Well, I am a former legislator as well. And right now, most of the energy, to be honest, for the end of this session is about the minimum wage. But the minimum wage debate also has a distinctly feminine face. And one of the areas I think is interesting where the wage gap is less the case is among poorer people because they're more likely to be paid hourly. That said, when you add it up, if it's a difference of $10,000, if you are a struggling family, $10,000 is a heck of a lot of money to make that difference. So from my point of view right now, right here, I'm working as much as I can on ensuring the minimum wage passes at as high a rate as possible, potentially being indexed, because right now it says the division between the House and Senate, and again, not in the legislature anymore. I can only opine sort of what effect there will be. And the governor, I know, is pushing very hard to see that through. But it is an ongoing issue. There are many pieces of legislation sponsored every year to put it into a better lens. But my office will always be there to push those sorts of legislation that will make things more equal.
The other thing I might add there, too, is if you go to the wage equity report that came out of the Women's Workforce Council, there's a 33 interventions that were identified as not, you don't need to do all 33. Organizations can look at sort of what the right combination are. There are these nudges that I think you referred to that really can start to get at the opportunity gap, which then gets at a large part at the wage gap.
Part of my job is to make sure we're doing that in state government. And guess where you'll see less of a wage gap for the same work? Government. Guess why? Salaries are published.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Kristen Ellico. I work for the Women's Fund of Western Massachusetts, and I lead their leadership development program. It's called the Leadership Initiative for Political and Public Impact. We're in the process of building our curriculum for next year, and I wonder if you have any ideas or thoughts in terms of how we could support these women who are looking to serve in government and other public positions. And secondarily, my question is also if you have an idea around a nudge in terms of having every individual put on a gender lens in terms of their philanthropy. Right now, it's probably about a third of women's philanthropy or philanthropic institutions receive the same amount of money as what is Greenpeace's operating budget. So when you look at the amount of money that's being directed towards funding women in any capacity, it's very low.
It is very low. And in terms of nudges, I'm going to let Iris Bohnet answer that question.
Thank you very much. So that's probably a longer question. I'm happy to have that conversation. I think any philanthropy, not just focused on women, can actually use lots of nudges. There's beautiful research around kind of when people give, why people give, how you frame the campaign, how you discuss issues, etc. And so I'm happy to have that conversation with you. But I don't think I have a good answer for why generally for women's causes it hasn't been very easy to fundraise for. I hope that stories such as, evidence, such as the one that I started with, that 150 million women are missing because they're killed, either infanticide or sex selective abortion, that this kind of evidence, the more you know, those kinds of pieces of evidence that we can share that are also close to home. So mine is not far away, but close to home, that might motivate some people to step up to the plate. But again, a longer conversation I'm happy to have. There's lots of ideas from the whole natural literature on how to be more successful in fundraising.
And Secretary Kaprielian, do you want to talk about the leadership piece?
The leadership piece of that.
Her interest in if there's particular things to help train women for political leadership.
Yes, well, there's a number of things already out there. I'm sure you know about Emerge, which is a nonprofit that gets people, you know, it convinces women who have an interest, who are self-selecting to run for office, to get out there. Because one of the things that's true is that this is common, that a lot of women before they run for office would think, well, I don't know enough. I promise you the men don't think that way. They don't. They get on, they're headlong, and they're going, and they learn what they need to know along the way. And women are such good listeners, and that is really half of what it is to lead and lead well, is to listen to the people you're representing and to try to make that difference, you know, in a real meaningful way in making laws and in trying to change the debate. In terms of our fellowships, please, I'll give you my card, please reach out to me, because I'd like to see some geographic diversity in some of those fellowships as well. Part of what we're gonna do, and I'm gonna sort of quarterback this, is to ensure that those women are networking with one another. In other circles, and to see themselves as leaders now and later.
I wasn't quite happy with my answer. I want to leave you with one concrete thing. As I was now reflecting about your question, something clicked for me. It said, you know, we don't have enough, only about a third, etc. So that is, in fact, a very interesting behavioral insight that we shouldn't frame things in terms of we don't have enough voters, so please go vote. We don't have enough contributors, so please contribute to our campaign. In fact, there's a lot of evidence suggesting that we all follow the herd. And in fact, on voting, there's a very nice research by Todd Rogers and others showing that when you remind people that most others are doing this, the likelihood that someone is going to vote is much higher. Same for contributions, same for, so some of my work has been focusing on gender diversity on corporate boards, and so we've helped the UK government, UK Secretary of Business, nudge corporations by reframing the discussion in the UK. And initially, they focused on the lack of women on corporate boards, and that's how we often talk about it. They started with 11% in 2011, and they committed the UK to increasing to 25% by 2015. And the reframing was not to focus on the lack of women, but to focus on the companies which are already gender diverse. And that's a majority. So now we can create a movement and saying, look, the thing to do these days is to have gender diverse teams. And so that's, I think, just a very concrete thing that you can think about in framing your campaign. So don't focus on the fact that not enough, but focus on the fact of who are the role models? How can we create, how can we make this the cool thing to do, the movement that we want to create?
Sure, and Megan Costello. Talking about politics, I have to add my two cents here. I think the other thing that is very interesting to me, working with somebody who's worked with a variety of candidates, you know, men will come to me and they'll be 22 years old and they think they, you know, have the confidence to run for president of the United States. A woman will come to me and say, I'm thinking about, you know, she's in her late 40s and she's accomplished, she's got, you know, 7 degrees and 5 kids and has done it all, and we'll say, I think I can run for school committee. You know, the difference in terms of what women think that they can do, because they're sometimes thinking, I need to be more prepared, I need to have all the expertise, and I call that the confidence gap, right? Like, we need to, as women, have the confidence that we are qualified to do a variety of jobs. And I think the other aspect of it as well is understanding that women also need to be asked in some ways to do things, to run for office. And that's one of the things that Emerge talks about. And so if you have friends of yours that are thinking about running for office or thinking about joining a board, or it doesn't necessarily have to be an elected position, make sure that you are asking them to do that. And I think that when we have more women, you know, in government, on boards, and a variety of areas, that we make better policy decisions. We talked about earlier the diversity of that. So, Sure, and I know many of you in this room know that here at the Kennedy School, we run from Harvard Square to the Oval Office. It's one of the programs of the Women in Public Policy program where we train our students. Oval alums in the room? Yay, yes. And those who are regional or based, Lori Ehrlich, the only woman in the House of Representatives to have a finance background, is one of our trainees. Michelle Wu, the first woman and only woman ever to have been elected, who's Asian American, to the Boston City Council, is one of our trainees. And I now want to recognize Janet.
Okay. I wanted to ask you, I'm from Houston, and don't hold that against me being from Texas, but I've been investigating complaints of discrimination for the last 20 years, 24,000 complaints. We also write affirmative action plans, so we have lots and lots of data. And one of the things that we run across in our data collection is when we write the affirmative action plans, we present the analysis, and most of the time we're presenting to men, and they tend to, you know, when I tell them there is a pay equity issue related to your men and women who are in similarly situated positions, they tell me, well, they come in and they don't ask for the money. I said, well, what am I supposed to do if they ask for less? And you know, I'm telling, you know, I'm talking about this and I'm saying, well, this is an engineering position. You want someone with 5 years and an engineering degree, and you also, you know, and they're the same, so they should be paid the same. And they said, well, men have families. I mean, I just had this conversation last week, just so you know, it wasn't like 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, I'm just really shocked. So my question is an initiative that trains women to go in and ask for it, go in and demand. You know, you don't have to go in and just pound, but be able to go in and show your worth. My firm investigated Lilly Ledbetter, just saying it. And when I was telling Goodyear, every time she got a wage, every time she got a check, it was a continuing violation. Their general counsel said, oh, Janet, you know, we're just going to take this to Supreme Court. But I was, you know, you just kept adding the dollars that she was not getting versus the men. And you know, I would hear them talk about this all the time. And so happy when the president signed the Lilly Ledbetter Act. But is there anything out there, because I have so much data about this that I've collected, thousands of affirmative action plans, is there anything out there that you guys are working on that with an initiative to teach women how to go in and ask for the money?
That sounds great. Hannah, do you want to begin?
Yeah.
Are we on?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I could respond. Yes, that's one thing to say. I mean, one thing, like, you know, in addition to the Lilly Ledbetter Fair Pay Act, you know, I, you know, draw attention to Obama's recent executive order, basically requiring that federal contractors make transparent compensation, and that they also, that no worker be penalized for discussing pay. You know, I mean, that's when it kind of, in a lot of organizations, these things are not, so you're not supposed to talk about these things, so you only talk to them with the people who are kind of close to you, right? And that, it is remarkable. The ambiguity effects are remarkable. I mean, one of the great things about transparency, making things transparent, is that what we find is it reduces gender differences in behavior, this propensity to negotiate. If you know that it's normative to negotiate and the types of things that people negotiate for you, you will you reduce that gender difference in women's lower propensity to negotiate. Secondly, if you make transparent what are the appropriate standards, you also minimize gender differences in outcomes, typically eliminate them. And it's not, for those people who are statistically minded, it's not because everybody does the same thing or everybody gets the same deal. It's literally that gender is just no longer, the variance is the same across conditions. It's just that gender is not predictive, you know, which is really remarkable. I mean, and the great thing about the transparency thing is that it doesn't mean you have to change the world, eliminate stereotypes, solve all those biases, you know, if you just simply find ways of giving men and women the same information. Then you're gonna eliminate some of these dynamics. I think that's very important. In terms of organizational interventions, you can also think about sometimes I think women, well, one thing, going back to your training, I think it's very important. I think what one thing, though, that is important is that women aren't trained to just act like the guys. Because we have a lot of research to show that can not pay off, or that has penalties in other ways. So I think if you do the training, you want to make it informed by the research on gender and negotiation and other things. But I think sometimes with regard to this ambiguity thing and getting the information, women might feel like, oh gosh, I've got to go be friends with the guys if I want to figure out, you know, how to do this. Oh, I've got to learn how to play golf or something. And actually, that's not necessarily the case. What you might need to just is figure out who is that person who can provide that information. I was on a panel a year or so ago at HBS with a woman who's the chief talent officer for a bank. We were talking about this challenge. She said, wow, I could be that person. She said, I won't tell you exactly what everybody has, but I can give you a sense of what's negotiable, what the range looks like, what types of things people get at different stages, what the paths look like. So I think also just finding, even just providing access to people who can enhance transparency is also another important strategy.
And just from the institutional perspective, we're going to see a shift that's going to take place in the United States unless these executive order and the executive, the memorandum, there were two things which were signed. Note, Women in Public Policy Program thinking was present and catalyzing in each of those things happening. Starting about 2 years ago in conversations that I had with Valerie Jarrett, Hannah's research was present there. But all federal contractors will be required to present wage data. The EEOC already investigates where they have cause. Having to present your wage data when you're applying means that you've just handed the government cause. So the entire sort of game of what this looks like is going to significantly shift. And Kathy, I thought you'd be the perfect person to talk about institutionally, what do you think, as a senior person in HR, about when someone doesn't ask for enough? Institutionally, what do you think the fixes are for that?
I think it's a number of the things that we talked about. I think it's trying to figure out how can you get information. Who are the people in your organization you can go to talk to? Start with your manager, start with people in human resources. I would say outside your organization, I look at information that exists out on websites like Glassdoor, salary.com. It's remarkably decent. It's not a bad starting point, and it's an easy way just to get a benchmark of where you're at. And you know, it's interesting, I just had a situation the other day where I had a woman who came to me and said, I was talking to my male colleague, we do the same job. He told me that he made $5,000 more than I did, and I'm very upset I've been here longer. So I said, okay, let me see what I can do, and I looked into the information, and lo and behold, he had told her the incorrect amount. He actually made less than she did. And so to this point about the right way of negotiating and the right way of thinking about this, I think it is about behaviors that may be different than what men use. But I do think there's information that you can arm yourself with, and I think that is very powerful.
We have come to 2:30. I know that there's lots of people who are still interested. I don't know if our panelists can stay a few minutes. And at 2:30, there's now a wonderful reception, which is the beginning of our closure of IDEASpHERE. Here at the Women in Public Policy Program, we are working year in and year out, trying to answer the questions the rest of the world does not yet know to ask. And it's through the generous support of so many of you who are in this room, and so many of you who are out at other sessions today, that we've been able to really have the funds to fundamentally shift the game of research. And when one is looking to Ford or MacArthur, a major foundation, they have program areas. They want to invest in thought lines that are already developed. What we do is change fields, change the frame for how the world is seen, and create new fields of inquiry so that we can fundamentally shift society beyond where the other pacemakers are. If you have interest in learning more about our work, this is how you can stay in touch with us and know what's going on. Do check out the Gender Action Portal. And once you're in there, you'll find all types of applications and it really sparks for one what you can do in your organization, what you want to research personally. For those of you who may be academics, if there's experimentally based papers that talk about how to close the wage gap or how to close gaps for women and girls, send us papers.
We're always interested in adding new. And then lastly, I'd like to thank all of you for coming, for being part of the Kennedy School community by continuing to push the envelope to make it vibrant. And let's give a round of applause for our panelists. Kathy Horgan, Secretary Kaprielian, Hannah Ryan.